And on this session, I'm going to be showing you how to service a gas fire. I'll be going through it step by step, giving you advice, going through some regulations with you as well, giving you advice about how to service it as an engineer and as an apprentice as well. So if you're going to go through your ACS training, hopefully you'll find this useful. So I've just turned up to the property, and the first thing I'm going to do is check for signs of spillage. And as you can see, this is clear. The next thing I'm going to do is just check the hearth and the carpets for any damage. Because obviously, sometimes tenants, owners, or previous engineers, they light matches, or they melt things near the appliance, and they can cause damage. So to eliminate that risk from me, I'm going to check the area first. Also, it's quite a good idea just to fire it up briefly first, so you know if there's any functioning issues. If there is, you know it was there prior to you starting. So let's begin then. So this is an inset fire. With this fire, it's vital that you put the coals back in the right place, because the coals actually direct the flame up the chimney. While you're doing this, it's always good to assess the surroundings. You could maybe ask the tenant or the owner if they've got a carbon monoxide alarm. And always check these fires under adverse conditions. So you could try opening and closing the window, try putting an extractor fan, try opening some doors. So you're really checking the fires functioning in both windy and dry conditions. Right then, so I'm going to start off now beginning. Let's start having a look at the appliance. Like always, I've got my brush, I've got my vacuum, and just to show off a bit, I've got some air freshener. So when I've serviced it and there's a smell of smoke pellets and smoke bombs, leave it smelling nice for the customer. Okay then, so here we begin. I've got my vacuum, so I can start off. The trick to being a good engineer is to always leave the appliance looking like it's being serviced. Too many people go in, rush the job, and it doesn't look like it's being serviced. It's vital to get repeat business. You leave it looking clean and serviced. If servicing gas appliances is a field that you want to go down, then what you can do is have some form of paperwork or admin service going, so you can have a text message or a phone call telling them that their appliance is due for a service. Landlord's appliances should be serviced every 12 months, and the record of the landlord certificate should be maintained and stored for at least 2 years. It's under regulation 36. That the landlord gets the appliance serviced every 12 months, regulation 36. So when you're filling out your landlord certificate, if you just make a note, regulation 36, it just makes you look more professional, doesn't it? This check that I'm doing now comes under regulation 26.9, which is the appliance safety and a list of the appliance safety checks. Okay. Just started the service and there's a smoke match there from the previous service, which is excellent. This is something that I do as well. I always leave my previous matches and pellets there, just to prove and as evidence that I have serviced it. On some appliances though, it can actually leave damp stains or corrosion stains. If you notice, I have actually taken the coals and the appliances out in a specific order. Front, middle and rear. So by looking at this, they all look in pretty good condition. Okay, and there's no real damage here whatsoever, and you can see straight away the mechanism here. The gas comes through these little pellets. It's directed using the coals and comes up through here like so and comes to the heat exchanger. This appliance is an inset living flame. So the kilowatt of this appliance is less than 7 kilowatt. If the appliance is less than 7 kilowatt, it doesn't need any additional ventilation. If it was a DFE fire, a directive effect fire, it would need 100 square centimetres. A DFE fire is where there's no burner, it's just an open-end gas pipe. You turn on a gas cock and the flame comes through. Okay. Underneath, there's a pedestal valve. Obviously, if you undo that, you can take the whole burner out. The main thing when you service gas fires is that the safety devices are working. It could be a pilot or with a thermocouple working off kilojoules heat energy, or it could be an atmospheric sensing device. If a gas appliance, open fluid, is in a bedroom, you should have some from a ventilation vitiation device or atmospheric sensing device. So if the fumes aren't going up the chimney gets hot and it switches off the appliance. So now I'm just going to give these coals just a brief clean, just to get all the loose bits of dirt off. And as you can see, it's really getting quite filthy already. Obviously, these bits of dirt can get in the pilot assembly, the pilot nipple. If you don't clean it out as well, it can make the flame yellow. Now, yellow flame can indicate lack of oxygen, or it could also mean there's dirt in the debris of the burner. So, I can tell straight away that these have been positioned correctly and the appliance is working correct, because there is no actual sooting stains on these fake coals. So far, I'm actually quite impressed. This is a class 1 chimney, which means it's a brick chimney, so you can plaster straight on top of it. I will be checking the chimney pot outside for leakage and for the terminal. If the terminal is less than 170mm, it will need a cage or terminal on, which is just to protect birds nesting and so forth. With these appliances, the burner pressure and the supply pressure is just as important as a boiler. Purely for the reason, if the supply or burner pressure is incorrect, the flame might not have the power to go directly to the chimney. It's very easy to get carbon monoxide poisoning from fires. All it takes is one small minor cobweb to go across the sectional area of the chimney. That cobweb will gather dust, and then in the winter time it could have condensation on it, moisture on it, it could frost, and then before you know it, that little cobweb has actually caused quite a lot of resistance. Also, if you do have an issue with the pull or the draw, you can try opening a window. If you open the window and you find that works, then if you measure the cross-sectional area of the window you've opened, then that will give you the ventilation requirement for the gas fire. Okay? So far, I'm quite satisfied with all this. A little clean round here. The tenant or the customer makes suggestions regarding how little they use the appliance, there's still an indication there that it could be dangerous. If they haven't used it much, then maybe there could be a habitation there of birds, insects. So it's still quite dangerous and it still needs reviewing. So now I'm going to check the flame. So there's the pilot. The flame is blue, it's accurate, and it's strong. It's not too fierce where you can hear a hissing noise, where it's burning too much gas and it's going to be doing damaging effects towards the metal, warping it, burning it or melting it. That is a good solid pilot. So it's hitting the safety device, the thermocouple, and it's also hitting the correct area for the burners to ignite. If you have an issue with the burners lighting with a bang or more of an explosion effect, that's due to the fact the pilot is too small. The gas is actually building up before it ignites. So I'm very satisfied with that. The next thing you have to do is blow the pilot light out and count how many seconds it takes for the actual gas valve to switch off. So here we go. So the pilot light has now switched off. It's always a good idea as well to have a check up the chimney. I will be doing a flue analyzer check on this and I will be taking the appliance out from the builder's opening. But for now, I'm just going to quickly do an inspection just for the sake of you learners watching it. Okay. So when you do a visual inspection of the chimney, put a torch up. You're looking for blockages, cobwebs. You're also looking for signs of a bird's nest up there, straw, bits of twigs. And also what can happen is, if a fire gets used quite regularly, the joints in the brickwork can become dry, and then the sand or the cement or the mortar can dry, turn to dust and fall to the bottom. Okay. So I've checked the pilot light, it's good. I've checked the condition of the thermocouple. I do talk about thermocouples in another video. And most of all, the ignition is strong. So if you look at the ignition is very strong there. It ignites straight away. The pilot has the correct length and it ignites straight away. I'm very happy and I'm very satisfied with that. Again, like some boilers, always check the length, the gap between the ignition electrode and the correct spot, i.e. either the, in this case it's the thermocouple, or that gap distance could be between the burner. So, if we zoom in here, if we look at the the appliance control train. You have pilot, ignition, small flame and large flame. So when you come to ignite this, you have it in the off position, you turn it to pilot, and then on the ignition symbol, you hold the button in, and that's for heat to create a magnet force in kilojoules at the thermocouple to maintain the magnet valve to stay open. Okay, so I'm very happy with that. I'm just going to turn that off. So now I'm going to put everything back in the same order. This is a magnet valve, which is in the back of this gas valve. And how the thermocouple works, the pilot light hits the thermocouple sends heat energy, and when you're pressing that valve in, you're actually pressing the spring in. Like so. So the pilot sends the heat energy to the back of the gas valve, which creates a magnet force, keeps the spring in. When I blew the pilot light out, it lost the heat, lost the kilojoules, lost the magnetic force, and the spring came loose. So I blew it, lost the heat, and after about 30 seconds, it came out. And this seating here on the spring represents the seating in the gas valve as well. So this is the magnetic valve. In the gas valve. If you ever take a gas valve out and you know the magnet valve works, you can always dismantle it and save it and use it as a thermocouple tester. I do mention thermocouples again in other training videos. Okay, so then let's put everything back here. Two holes here, look, just sliding these two sections here, one, two, one section there, and one section there. All appliances, gas appliances, come with a data badge. And that data badge is usually at the base, or on the casing, or on the side of appliance. That data badge is vital for information when ordering parts. We have what we call a gas council number, and that council number is ideal for recording, for when you service, do an animal certificate. And if you ever have any further problems with that appliance, if you have that gas council number, you can order new parts and spares. As well as the gas council number, I always write down the serial number. The serial number indicates when the appliance was made. So the gas council number is the model, the appliance. The serial number will tell the manufacturer or the supplier what year it was made. Okay. A lot of people now are changing gas fires and turning to electric purely for the cost of gas now. So if you do take your gas fire out, always make sure you cap it off. Don't just leave the appliance turned off at the pedestal valve and leave an open end. It is always good when testing the flue, you allow at least 5 minutes for the chimney or the flue to warm up. The reason being, the product combustion will find it easier to locate in the room where it's warmer than at the chimney. If the chimney is higher, if the chimney is external of the dwelling and is higher than 11 meters, it needs lining.